Hello. So, today I am going to read my book that I'm reading. I'm almost 3/4 of the way done. I had this book recommended to me from a podcast. The podcast is called Psychic Teachers, and it's a wonderful place for psychic knowledge and things about opening up to psychic intuition. So, that's what this book is about. This book is actually by a super famous actress who's an actress in some Hitchcock movies. So she's an old-timey actress. And she wrote this book late 80s. So before New Age spirituality was accepted and it was taboo, and she was ridiculed and mocked. And so it's really an impressive book to me, because it was before a time where people weren't really talking about this stuff. So I'm just gonna pick up from where I last read. Put on my glasses. Might be a little loud. And I will start where I left off and read for a little bit. We'll see how long I want to read. There's no pictures, but it is very compelling. A lot of times I go back and I highlight things that she said because it's a new perspective to someone who's just waking up to spirituality, and it's a good refresher. So, I will read the back of the book, and this is not her first book. That's why it says, her most fascinating, most controversial book is one you will never forget. So, she's written a few books before. Surprisingly, some of them about spirituality, which means she was starting to slowly, naturally wake up to this awareness. I will read the back of the book just so new people can, turn that off, just so new people can find out where we are. An outspoken thinker, a celebrated actress, a truly independent woman, Shirley McLaine goes beyond her previous two bestsellers to take us on an intimate yet powerful journey into her personal life and inner self. An intense, clandestine love affair with a prominent politician sparks Shirley McLean's quest of self-discovery. From Stockholm to Hawaii to the mountain fastness of Peru, from disbelief to radiant affirmation, she lasts discovers the roots of her very existence and the infinite possibilities of life. Shirley MacLaine opens her heart to explore the meaning of a great and enduring passion with her lover, Jerry, the mystery of her soul's connection with her best friend, David, the tantalizing secret great actor's inspiration with the late Peter Sellers, and through it all, Shirley MacLaine's courage and candor opens new doors, new insights, new revelations, and a luminous new world she invites us all to share. I often forget that this book is about a love affair because her self-discovery is so interesting to me. So, as it's said on the back of the book, it goes from Stockholm to Hawaii to Peru. And the part that I'm at, she's Shirley MacLaine. Is about to go to Peru. And she's with her friend, David. And that is where I last left off. So, I think from there, it should be easy to follow along. So this is my first book reading video. Okay. Let's see how long I want to read. By the way, my book marker is a eucalyptus leaf. Chapter 19. On the night flight to Peru, it was like the old days when I took off whenever I wanted to. Free and unencumbered, spur-of-the-moment adventure, alone and traveling swiftly. I dropped contently to sleep. When I woke up, I was over Lima, somewhere under the soup of smog. There was a coastal city. It was worse than Los Angeles. I filled out my entrance card, declared the money I had brought with me, and wondered what a South American military dictatorship would be like. I disembarked at the Jorge Chavez airport to a chilly morning in an open airport that was made out of cement. I hadn't told anyone where I was going. I hadn't wanted to. I just said I was leaving town on a trip. Most of my friends and my agent were used to that. There were many international travelers on board. Not only returning Peruvians, obviously Lima was a center for international business, mostly shady, illegal, and having nothing to do with helping the plight of the poor, I thought. There was again a rich, bleeding heart liberal. No one recognized me when I produced my papers and passport. It didn't make any impression. The customs, police, luggage carriers, airport authorities, everyone wore uniforms like leftovers from a Keystone Cops. And the people acted that way too. I expected rigid Gestapo-like military behavior, even though the government was supposed to be a left-wing military group. I didn't know anything about Peru. I only knew of the Inca civilization, the Nazca Plains, and the fact that most of Peru had mountains. I had packed one fair-sized suitcase with warm and cold weather clothes, a pair of combat boots, and lots of tape and a tape record, and a notepad. Whatever was going to happen to me, I wanted it down in writing. Except for the fact that I didn't fill out one document in triplicate. Nothing untoward happened as I passed through customs and waited for my suitcase on the other side. The sun had just come up to take the chill off the air when I looked over at the wall where people waited for arrivals. I didn't recognize anyone. The cement airport couldn't have been more depressing. The baggage carousel turned down and tumbled my suitcase. I picked it up along with my hand luggage and made my way to the street where I would look around and see more than decide whether to take a cab into town. I wasn't frightened. I walked toward the front entrance of the airport, and just as I saw a dilapidated cab that looked as though it might take me to the local Sheraton, I felt someone take my suitcase out of my hand. Quickly, I turned and looked into the face of David. "Hi," he said. He had a woolen scarf wrapped around his neck and a combat jacket zipped up to the front. He was tan and smiling. "Hi, you're Mr. Livington, I presume. Anything you say, ma'am. Did you have a good trip?" "It was okay. Welcome to the mountains I love very much. They have saved my life many times." "They are peaceful," I looked into his eyes, not needing to know any more than that. "Come," he said, "don't mind my jalopy, but I can't get a Land Rover. That's the best way to travel in the mountains." "The mountains?" I asked. "We're going right away to the Andes?" "Sure, it would be hard to avoid. Peru is the Andes. But wait till you see them. They're different from the Himalayas, but just as gorgeous." He picked up both bags and led me to an old red rental Plymouth, which was parked alongside a dirt road adjacent to the airport. "Did you eat breakfast on the plane?" "Yep." "Okay, then we'll stop and get some provisions before we head straight for Lancampa. The pollution mixed with fog made me cough. I had thought of Lima as a sun-splashed resort city by the sea with perfect climate and people rushing around in South American muumuus. This was dank, damp, dingy, and depressing. David, there was a legend based on the fact about Lima. When Pizarro invaded the Incan civilization by way of peace offering, the Incas directed Pizarro's army to make their base camp here in what was now Lima. They proudly showed their conquering masters this territory during the months of January and February, which were the most exquisite months for weather and locally, and indeed anywhere in the world. But that was it. The rest of the year was dismal. As soon as the army settled in, the weather changed. The Incas professed it would be an accident, but of course, it never got any better, and in no time, most of Pizarro's armies had pneumonia. I'll go to 20 minutes because after 20 minutes can be kind of hard to upload to YouTube. Book's getting good. Hey, what about those Incas? How come they were so intelligent? I asked. I guess they were easy to help, David said. Primitive people don't fight miracles. They relax and figure somebody else knows better than they. Like who? He just winked. Oh, I said, I forgot. I pointed upward and patted my knee. David lit up one of his camels and asked if there was anything special about being needing because we were going. If there was a kerosene lantern around, we'd be lucky. I know you're used to roughing it, he said, but this time there won't be any Sherpas or bearers or anybody to do anything for you except yourself. He suggested the toilet paper, basic canned food, a hot water bottle, anything to keep yourself warm. He said there was no heat where we were going either. I thought of the time when I spent in a hut in the Himalayas, when I was sure I would freeze to death. My only recourse had been to employ some sort of mind over matter technique. So I concentrated on the hottest thing I could think of, the sun. Shivering and chattering, I lay down on a makeshift cot, closed my eyes, and somewhere in the center of my mind, I found my own orange sun. I concentrated as hard as I could. Before long, I felt perspiration drift from my midriff, and finally, I had the impression that daylight had come in my mind. Every night for the 2 weeks I spent in the Himalayan snow, I used that technique. Now, it looked as though I might have to do it again. I was afraid I was out of practice. The road leading to Lima was paved with clogged and smoking, spewing trucks and dirty cars. People nonchalantly walked around in gray, overworn business shirts. I wondered what offices they worked in so early in the morning. Lima's on the brink of a revolution, said David. The rate of inflation is climbing so rapidly that people find it impossible to live. And as usual, it's poor who suffer the most. Their salaries stay the same. The prices rise. Anyway, I'm not too interested in how the government here is screwing things up. It would just be a question of time, anyway. It's only symptomatic of what's going on with governments all over the world, right? I nodded. Now to a Peruvian supermarket for basics, okay? It felt strange to be in a new place, and yet at the same time that it's being new was not really why I was here. The so-called supermarket was little, like a small New York privately owned market, not quite a delicatessen on First Avenue, maybe, but I had the feeling the proprietors could raise their prices whenever they felt like it. The meats and cheeses and breads and pastries were housed in glass enclosed cases, and a soft drink called Inca Cola seemed to be David's favorite staple. He bought a case of it and a bottle opener. He opened one bottle right there and shook the fizz out of it and drank it down. Between cigarettes and this delicious crap, I guess you could say I'm not exactly on a health resort. Remembering my low blood sugar, I bought canned nuts, tuna fish, cheese, and a dozen eggs that I hope I would be able to hard boil somewhere. There were many Peruvian pastry delicacies, but I couldn't eat them, and I found myself wondering what it would be like if I had a low blood sugar attack in the mountains. So I think that's a good place to stop for now, and I maybe can make another book